Unfortunately, public health dictates that we host this meeting virtually because not enough Carroll Countyans got their shots and wear their masks. So we're doing this again, but hopefully only for a few weeks. Please note that our meetings will continue to be available and streamed live on the city's YouTube page, as well as the Community Media Center channel and website. Now we'll begin as we do every meeting with the Pledge to the Flag, followed by a moment of silence. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Copies of tonight's agenda and the entire information packet that the council will be using are available online on the city's website. Before we go any further, I just want to take a moment to welcome our new city clerk, Mr. Doug Barber. Mr. Barber, welcome. We're looking forward to working with you.
Thank you.
Now, first, we'll consider the approval of the minutes. We have minutes from the meeting of the mayor and council on December 13th, 2021. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
Moved.
There's been a motion by Mr. Dayhoff and a second by Ms. Gilbert. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. The ayes seem to have it, and the ayes have it, and the motion carries. We have one presentation tonight. I'd like to welcome Ms. Vicki Slinkman from Ting to give her quarterly report. Ms. Slinkman, welcome once again.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everyone, and Happy New Year. I trust everyone had a fantastic holiday season. All right, sorry, just waiting for the presentation to get up. Thank you, Mr. Barber. Do you want to hop on to slide 3 and we'll delve right into the numbers? Awesome, thank you so much. So we had another great quarter. I'm very happy to report. We grew 6% from the last quarter. So that brings our take rate to 33%. Previously, it was 31%. So awesome growth in the number of subscribers between the quarters. This growth is mainly driven by our marketing efforts, our door-to-door sales team, as well as a promotion that we ran with Westminster Way, which is the new apartment complex on West Main Street. Next slide, Mr. Barber, please. And next. Thank you. So we attended a lot of fantastic events. As always, the city has so many opportunities for us to get out and work with the community. So we sponsored, not pictured here, the Spooky Sprint, as well as the Jingle Bell Run. In October, we sponsored the Run for Resilience, which is put on by the Rape Crisis Intervention Service. We also sponsored the 4th annual Shantae You Stay drag show, which is put on by the Westminster chapter of PFLAG. And so thrilled that we could be a part of Exploration Commons, and we are sponsoring the AR/VR lab. Wanna hop on next? Thank you. So then in terms of our campaigns that we ran over the quarter, we ran a Veterans Day campaign during the month of November, which we promoted via direct mail and social media advertising. And the goal of the campaign was really to help raise money for the Carroll County Veterans Independence Project. So for every order that we received during the month of November, we were able to make a donation, and we were able to raise over $1,000 to donate to that fantastic organization. And next slide. Thank you. A campaign that we started running in December and we're going to continue into January is what we called our Giving Back campaign. And again, the idea here was to, you know, offer our residents fantastic internet, but also give something back to the community. So similarly to our Veterans Day campaign, we selected a local charity. And for every order that we receive during that period, December 1st through January 15th, we're going to be donating $25 to Carroll County Food Sunday. And that concludes my update. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Ms. Lindman? All right, well, hearing none. Thank you for a good report. Again, glad to see that the percentages keep going up, and we're looking forward to continuing to grow the you know, the participation in the fiber network, and look forward to another great report next quarter. Thanks very much.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Take care. Now move on to approval of the consent calendar. We have one item on the consent calendar this evening. May I have a motion to approve the consent calendar?
Motion to approve.
And a motion by Mr. Dayhoff. Is there a second?
Second.
And then a second by Mr. Cavacci. All those in favor of approving the consent calendar, please say aye.
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 Those say nay. The ayes seem to have it. The ayes have it. And the consent calendar is approved. Thank you very much. Now we'll have the report from the mayor, Dr. Becker.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let me shift my view here a little bit to the one other screen I have open. So I'm sort of multitasking here with some different computers. Well, first of all, I want to say I hope everyone had a wonderful holiday season and you were able to enjoy time safely with your friends and your family. Before I begin, I want to echo Council President Pecoraro's statement in welcoming Doug Barber to the city. I hope you've been settling in into your new role in just the week or so that you've been here. The last month has been a little quiet in some aspects, but on December 17th, I attended the ribbon cutting and opening along with some other members of the council and staff of the Exploration Commons at the Westminster Public Library. If you have not gotten to the Exploration Commons, I really encourage you to go and check out the space that they have there. It's really phenomenal in everything that they offer, and I think that it will bring a lot of engagement to downtown Westminster. I just want to say a real quick public thank you to our city administrator, Ms. Sarah Imhulse. With the surge of COVID after holidays, I think that week between Christmas and New Year's, we were on the phone sometimes for 3 hours every day, sort of brainstorming, talking about strategies and information related to COVID. And I want to say that Ms. Imhulse was incredibly proactive in her agenda and planned for staff outages and implementing the protocols that we have put into place to ensure the continuity of services. And I really appreciate your work over the holidays and so far into the month of January. I won't take away from any other committees, but I did want to mention that we had a very good fiber committee meeting on January 5th, led by former council member Dr. Robert Wack. And I want to say thanks to Vicki for her presentation. I don't know if she's still on the call, but I'm thankful that Ting is such a strong partner with the city through their sponsorship of events. As well as running or being the internet server for the city's Wi-Fi. The Winter's Farmers Market will open on February 5th, something which I'm very much looking forward to. And then finally, before I end, I just wanna say thank you to all the employees of the city who've been pulling some extra time to cover the staff outages for those who are ill, especially during our most recent snow event. I would like some more snow. I'm told I cannot wish for snow overnight or on the weekends, but I can wish for snow during the day. So I have been doing so, but I know it hasn't been an easy couple weeks and I'm hopeful that things are better. So please stay healthy, well, and thank you. That's all, Mr. President.
All right. Thank you very much, Mayor Becker. Move on now to reports from the standing committees. We'll begin as we always do with the report from our Arts Council liaison, Mr. Dayhoff.
Thank you, Mr. President. Effective January 1st at the Carroll Arts Council, masks are going to be required. And also, in addition to masks, folks visiting the Arts Council are going to be required to show their proof of their vaccination or show a negative PCR test. And this is actually, interestingly enough, this is actually increased attendance at some of the functions because you have a certain amount of comfort level that folks that are attending the function are relatively safe with COVID and the Omicron variant. I think we announced earlier, I'm not sure if we did or not, but we're really excited that on December the 14th, we announced that the local artist Lynn Griffith, a Carroll County native, is going to step up to the position of the executive director of the Carroll Arts Council. We're really excited about that. I was joined by Councilwoman Ann Gilbert on January the 6th for a preview of the Icons of Animation. And that's a joint show that we're having with McDaniel College. This is a really, really exciting show. It's 150 pieces of original animation art. And the show is simply extraordinary. You can't take it all in one viewing. So plan to visit several times. On Friday, January the 14th, we're going to continue our feature film series for January with a feature film on the life and times of James Baldwin. James Baldwin was close friends with Medgar Evers and Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. And this is a personal account about the lives and accomplishments and unfortunately the assassinations of three of his close friends. For Martin Luther King Day on January 17th, we are going to have a national touring production of The Struggle for Freedom, The Life of Dr. King, and that's going to come to the Carroll Arts Center. And finally, Mr. President, on Saturday, January the 22nd, we're going to look forward to a national theater production of A Raisin in the Sun. That'll conclude my report. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Dayhoff. I appreciate that very much. Welcome to Ms. Griffith. She's a terrific addition to the Arts Council, and I know we're all looking forward to her leadership there. Move on now to the Economic and Community Development Committee. Mr. Hoff.
Yes. I just want to let everybody know our next Economic and Community Development Committee meeting is going to be Thursday, January the 20th at 3:30. Of course, because of the rise in COVID numbers, we will be meeting virtually. Just like this council meeting. And between all the COVID-related issues and staffing issues, Ms. Imholz and I had discussed, we're gonna just kind of for the next month or two, gonna be concentrating on critical things that need to be done. Some of our longer term stuff, we're just gonna kind of put to the side for the next month or two, just to give us a chance to kind of breathe a little bit to get caught up otherwise. So that's the basic plan right now. Thanks.
All right, very good. Thank you, Mr. Hoff. I have nothing to report from the Finance Committee except that we will have a meeting coming up very soon, start talking about the budget process. We're working that out with the city administrator. We'll announce the date of that very shortly. Personnel Committee, Ms. Gilbert.
Yes. Just as the rest of the county and state has experienced an uptick in COVID transmissions and the positivity rates, we in the city also have experienced the same increase among our employees. And in response to this, our city administrator and our personnel department have been absolutely working endlessly, pivoting in multiple directions at any day to ensure that we have a continuity of operations. They have created, in collaboration with the health department, new updated protocols for our employees who are vaccinated and unvaccinated. Ms. McCullough, I want to congratulate you. You've been absolutely wonderful in all this. Her and her team have been hard at work at processing the testing protocols and ensuring staff safety, and also that we have continuity of services. I feel like I've repeated that twice now. All staff have been wonderful working with each of their departments, and I want to thank all of them. I know Madam Mayor has already stated this, but I'll reiterate that also. So I wanted to thank all of them. I, as everyone else, will be quite happy when we start seeing lower numbers and a return to some relaxed protocols. But for now, everybody's working hard at making sure we all stay safe and everything stays working. So that's all I have for personnel for right now.
Thank you, Ms. Gilbert. Mr. Cavacci, public safety.
Thank you, Mr. President. A couple of quick things. I know the chief has some things to go over, but I wanted to touch on just one or two of them. First, we've had some positive movement in terms of hiring police officers. You know, that's a very challenging thing to do right now. And a lot of departments are really challenged to fill their requirements for law enforcement officers. And we're, of course, you know, not completely immune to that, but things have moved in a positive direction. I think a lot of that has to do with the leadership of our police department, you know, and the esprit de corps that
pictures.
I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. I was getting some. So we've gotten some good some good folks, and I know the chief's going to talk a little bit more about that. But you know, considering everything that's going on societally right now, the fact that we're able to hire quality people, some laterals and things like that, I think speaks volumes to the job that our senior leadership's doing, and overall the department in terms of their esprit de corps and morale. So that's wonderful. I'd also like to just quickly note that our state's attorney put out a press release related to dealing with the heroin crisis. I'll let the chief speak a little bit more on that, but in that press release, he specifically compliments the chief and all of his efforts that he's doing to try to thwart that problem or at least mitigate it. And he goes, you know, into a couple sentences talking about the chief and the work that he's doing. We've already spoke about that a few times, but I just wanted to highlight that, you know, the state's attorney took the time to put that in writing out to the public. So kudos, chief, on that. And then lastly, the chief put out a letter of recognition related to Sergeant Adam Laser. And I'm not going to go into detail in terms of the incident, but Sergeant Laser was involved in a situation where an individual received some very terrible news and was very distraught dealing with it. He showed a tremendous amount of compassion, leveraged the correct resources to get her help and stayed with her throughout the situation and gave her a lot of comfort to the point where her family reached out to the police department and wanted to make sure that he was commended and to thank him for his efforts. So I'd like to personally thank Sergeant Laser for, once again, as many of our police officers do, bringing great credit upon the Westminster Police Department. That's it, Mr. President.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Cavacci. And we'll turn back to you for Public Works Committee.
Yeah. The only thing with Public Works, you know, they typically have to deal with, you know, the regular water main breaks and sewage blockages and things like that. And that's always a little bit more challenging, you know, this time of year when it's so cold out. But of course, one of the big things here recently they had to deal with was our snow event that took place over a number of days. And it was a lot. We put down quite a bit of salt brine and salt overall. And they plowed 1,970 miles worth of roadway within the city. And given the fact that the city is 7 miles, I think that's a lot of back and forth on a lot of streets. So they did a great job. We're always very fortunate, you know, as I travel in and around the area. It's always nice to get back into Westminster during a snow event because our roads are always the best in terms of being taken care of. So compliments to Mr. Glass and his staff. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cavacci. And also, I just want to note that this was Ms. Imhulse's first snow event. That's often a make or break for city administrators, and things went well. So congratulations, you made it through your first snow. We'll turn now to Recreation and Parks Committee. Mr. Dayhoff, for your report.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll defer to Director Gruber for the Recreation and Parks Committee report. Thank you.
All right, very good. And I have nothing to report this evening for the Technology Committee. Move on now to council comments and discussion. This is an opportunity for council members to raise anything that's on their minds, whether it's on the agenda this evening or not. And we'll begin with Mr. Cavacci. Nothing from Mr. Cavacci today? All right, very good. Mr. Dayhoff. Mr. Dayhoff, council comments?
Yes, thank you. A couple of things. It's with mixed emotions that we announced the retirement of the MML Executive Director, Scott Hancock. I think the announcement came out today publicly. I spent a good bit of time talking with Mr. Hancock last Friday. He has served the MML and served municipalities throughout the state extremely well for many years. We all want to congratulate him and wish him for a great retirement. Historical Society. The Historical Society, this year's Carroll County birthday celebration will be held on Saturday, January the 15th. That's an annual event, and it's always a really good event. This year, the presentation is going to be on the history of Oakland Mill, which of course was covered by Liberty Reservoir many years ago. I've written about it on a number of times. The presentation is going to be by Diane Scott, if I'm not mistaken. And yeah, it is, Diana Scott. She's gonna make that presentation. I've worked with a number of organizations dealing with the Omicron variant, COVID-19. So I also want to echo the thoughts of thanking Ms. Imholtz and Ms. McCullough for all their hard work on dealing with the recent surge. And we're also really excited about Exploration Commons. We've been working on that for quite some time. So I'm excited to see that come forward. That's gonna bring that many more folks in town. We wanna welcome City Clerk Barber. Thank you. That's welcome aboard. And then I think I have Community Services Council is going to cancel their January meeting because of the positivity rate. And I think I have a question, not necessarily that we need to answer it now, but I've been asked by a number of folks recently about the project to hang the veterans banners on Main Street. I think that was an initiative that was brought forward by Mr. Cavacci and Ms. Gilbert. And I've been asked by several folks about that. So we'll look forward to maybe hearing a report about that in the near future. And I think that's it, Mr. President.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Dayhoff. And sorry to learn of Scott Hancock's retirement. He's led MML well for years, and of course is a what was formerly called Western Maryland College, now McDaniel, graduate. So he has ties to Westminster and has always been a good friend of the city of Westminster. So we're sorry to see him go.
The interesting thing is that the person who's going to head the search committee is the son of a friend of mine and Scott's, who attended Western Maryland College, who's now the head of Purdue, if I'm not mistaken. But Jake Day is now the mayor of Salisbury, and his dad is now the head of Peru and his Purdue, and they both attended Western Maryland College with my wife Caroline Babylon.
Well, maybe the alumni should start looking at the job posting.
Thank you.
Ms. Gilbert.
I think many folks have already hit most of my council comments. I did want to mention that since our last council meeting, we were lucky enough to have a Christmas or a holiday party with our employees, and it happened to be in person. So I want to thank the organizers and the staff for enabling that celebration to occur and to occur safely. So it was wonderful seeing everybody, and I think everyone had a great time. So I want to thank everyone who allowed that to happen. The mayor and Councilman Dayhoff mentioned about the ribbon cutting at Exploration Commons. So I'm going to skip all my notes on that. And I will mention that last week there was a private opening. I believe Councilman Dayhoff mentioned that with the American Animation. And again, I also will reiterate that if you have any chance of stopping by, take a peek and look at the ink and watercolor drawings on paperboard. A lot of great history to go back to, all the cartoons all of us grew up with. I learned as I did that Mickey Mouse once was a rabbit. I never knew that. Who would have thought? So that will be taking place at the Carroll County Arts Center and Rice Gallery. And I will follow up with Councilman Dayhoff's question about the veterans flags. We are hoping that they will be up and ready to order at the end of January. I believe there's going to be an email coming out this week to Ms. Imhals and to Mr. Glass, verifying a few couple things so that we can tie up those loose ends and get ready to get that off the ground and going by Memorial Day. So hopefully that answers your question, Councilman Dayhoff. And that's all I have.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Gilbert. And Mr. Hoff.
My only comment is I miss seeing everybody in person. So hopefully this won't be too long that we're in this virtual world yet again. I feel like I kind of jinxed something because I finally had our first planning and zoning meeting live, and now we're back in a virtual world. So I don't know, coincidence or what, but anyway, it's a necessary evil for the time being, but I certainly look forward to being back in person, hopefully here within the next couple of weeks. So we'll see.
As do we all. All right. And I have nothing this evening that has already been mentioned, so we'll just move along. We have next item is bids. We have one item tonight under bids, award of contract for inflow and infiltration phase 4 project. Mr. Glass.
Yes, sir. The current capital projects sewer fund includes funding for the continuation of the city's inflow and infiltration work in the sewer collection system. Project was advertised on November 2nd, 2021 on the eMerlin Marketplace with a pre-bid meeting and bid due dates of November 23rd and December 20th, respectively. Two bids were received, with one unfortunately found to be incomplete upon review and has been rejected. The remaining bid is from Geyer Brothers. They were, as you may recall, the successful phase 3 contractor, and that bid is in the amount of $1,530,984. City staff has reviewed and evaluated the references and the bid from Geyer's and finds it to be acceptable within with regard to the city's needs. And of course, we're satisfied with the phase 3 work that, that we obtained in the previous contract. It's worth noting that our project funding is only $1 million, but for this year, but much like we do for the annual roadway paving, the project size was purposely made larger, and the reason for that is to fully expend the budget, but of course not to exceed it. At this point, staff would recommend that the Mayor and Common Council accept the bid of Geyer Brothers of New Enterprise, Pennsylvania, up to the full budgeted and not to exceed amount of $1 million for the inflow and infiltration reduction work, as further described in the bid documents, and of course authorize the mayor's execution of the associated contract. And I'd be happy to answer any questions if there would be any.
All right, thank you, Mr. Glass. You've all heard Mr. Glass's report. May I have a motion to award the contract?
Motion to approve.
All right, there's a motion by Mr. Dayhoff and a second by Mr. Hoff. And I believe Mr. Hoff wanted to either make a comment or ask a question.
Mr. Glass, just for my benefit as being new on council, so, and I think I remember seeing this before with, I think, the roadway. So what we do is we get a bid for more work than what are budgeted for so that we make sure we spend our allocated amount, in this case, $1 million. And so we go up to that point, and then whatever other work we aren't able to do will just happen in a future year. Is that correct?
That's correct. We would hope that anything not completed in this budget process in this year would just roll forward then to the, hopefully, we don't know how much we'll get for the next budgeted year, but that would be seed work, of course, for any money that we would get.
Understand. Okay. I just wanted to understand a little bit better process-wise. Thank you.
No problem. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Hoff. Any other questions or comments? Mr. Glass, so you'll recall that when we started doing this, ramping up the effort on I&I under Mayor Dominic, you know, the goal was to do as much as we could in a year. I take it we're still doing that?
Yes, sir. That's correct. We, with the understanding
it's so valuable to get it done.
Yes, sir. 100%. With the understanding that that $1 million per year will stretch for a few, hopefully, that a few years, that is, we'll be prepared to expend those funds accordingly.
Right. And we've made significant progress in terms of managing our wastewater problem by doing this. Isn't that correct?
Yes, sir. That is 100% correct. We had flows back in 2018. Average daily flows were in the 7 million gallon per day range. We are currently at about 4.1 or 2 million gallons per day.
That's great. Well, it's been money well spent. That's good news.
Yes, sir.
Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to a vote. All those in favor of awarding the contract, please say aye.
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 Those opposed say nay. The ayes seem to have it, and the ayes have it. And the contract is awarded. Thank you, Mr. Glass.
Yes, sir, you're welcome.
There are no new ordinances or resolutions on the table that I'm aware of. Move on to new business. The one item there is approval of change order number one to the city's contract with Wallace Montgomery for the Hahn Road Water Main Improvement Project, excuse me. And Mr. Glass, I presume we're back to you for that.
Yes, sir. The current capital projects water fund budget includes funding for the engineering and replacement of the water main in Hahn Road at its intersection with Maryland Route 27. The project consists of replacement of sections in Route 27 as well as in Hahn Road, which includes a bore and jack as necessary to cross the Maryland Midland Railroad. That bore and jack would end just beyond the lateral connection at Penguin Random House. So that's quite a process to make that happen. On May 10th, the Mayor and Common Council accepted the bid of Wallace Montgomery of Hunt Valley, Maryland, and authorized the mayor's execution of that contract in the amount of $70,067.86 for the engineering portion of this work. Unfortunately, due to the considerable physical constraints of the existing utilities, issues that we have, and the railroad itself, an additional easement was necessary from Penguin Random House, which is, of course, outside the paved surface, but within an area of environmental concern. The work associated with this additional survey and legal development includes wetland delineation, floodplain impact, and environmental permitting, which were all outside the original scope of services. As a result, this additional work necessitates a change order to the city's contract with Wallace Montgomery. This change order has an associated cost of $22,752.74. The budget for this project is $275,000, so the monies to cover change order one are available in that current water fund budget. And at this point, the staff would recommend that Common Council approve change order number one to the city's contract with Wallace Montgomery and authorize its execution by the mayor as well. And again, I would answer any questions you may have.
All right, thank you, Mr. Glass. Can I get a motion to approve change order number one?
I'll make motion a motion to approve change order number one.
All right, there's been a motion by Ms. Gilbert and a second by Mr. Dayhoff of the motion to approve change order number one. Any discussion? Other questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to a vote. All those in favor of approving change order number one, please say aye.
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 Those opposed say nay. The ayes seem to have it and the ayes have it, and the change order is approved. There you go, Mr. Glass, keep working.
Yes, sir.
There is no unfinished business of which I'm aware. So move on to departmental reports. And for that, we turn to our city administrator to lead the team, Ms. Imhals.
Thank you, sir. Can everyone hear me okay?
Just fine, excellent. Thanks.
Happy New Year. Glad to see you all again. I'm gonna start today with the fire department report. Councilmember Dayhoff.
Thank you, Ms. Imhals. For the month of December, the total calls for service were 633. The EMS calls were 523. Fire calls were 110. 359 of the calls were in the city limits, and 195 of the calls were outside the city limits. The one worrisome statistic is 55% of the calls were overlapping, meaning we had to bring in other agencies to come in and help us. The total calls for 2020 were 6,025. The total calls for 2021 were 6,676, or an increase in 1 year of 651 calls more than last year. My report continues with some of the staffing challenges and response challenges that we've had as a result of the Omicron variant. Locally, the surge has caused significant challenges with staffing in the fire service and EMS service in Carroll County. It has throughout the state, throughout the Mid-Atlantic region. Currently, 25% of all of the county fire and EMS employees are out on sick leave. To make matters worse, the local hospital has been frequently on reroute due to lengthy offboarding times, or the hospital has had no more capacity for additional patients. This means that the medic units need to go to, they need to transport patients to hospitals in Hanover or Gettysburg or Howard County, Baltimore or Frederick County. That entails a good bit of time in which that unit is not available in the Westminster area to go up to, say, for example, Gettysburg and come back. The other interesting challenge is that the wait times at the emergency room at the local hospital can be as long as 6 hours. So that is by the time an ambulance, a medic unit arrives at the emergency room, it could be as long as 6 hours before they're able to offboard that patient. In Carroll County and in Westminster, we've made a number of significant measures to maintain core services during the influx of COVID cases in the community. We have essentially halted all non-emergency activities. The other measure that we've adopted is upstaffing or overstaffing to provide 3 medic units instead of 2 medic units in Westminster. Usually we staff 2 medic units. Unfortunately, another measure that we have had to employ is called holdover. We've had to hold over providers, causing responders to work as much as 2 24-hour shifts, or in some cases, 3 24-hour shifts. I stopped by the station before I came into the meeting, and several folks, as we speak, are dealing with 36-hour and 48-hour shifts. So as you can imagine, this puts quite a mental and physical strain on the fire and EMS providers. To increase the challenges, recently county EMS operations show a 30% increase in EMS responses in the last month during peak demand hours between 9 o'clock and 8 o'clock. So far, through careful planning, there's been little impact on response times. However, we could use a little bit of help. We need to urge citizens to only call 911 in life or death emergencies. 911 abuse has been a commonly discussed narrative in the community for quite some time. It seems to have gotten worse recently. So we need to put out that call that we really only need to call 911 in life or death emergencies. Meanwhile, getting vaccinated against COVID-19 and following health and safety protocols like masking are the best ways that the public can help support EMS providers. That's my report. I look forward to a better report in the future, Mr. President. Ms. Imholz, thank you.
Thank you, sir. And if we have our planning director on board, we're gonna scoot over to the planning department for their report. Mr. Depot.
Thank you, good evening. bear with me. On Wednesday, January 5th, the Historic District Commission reviewed the demolition permit for 288 East Main Street again, as well as additional architectural information provided by the property owner. The HDC is planning an on-site visit of the property, but not entering the building at all. We are planning a trip for HDC, and then hopefully following that, a special meeting to discuss the demolition permit further. They approved the facade improvement program application for 229 East Main Street, and they reviewed a section 106 filing for Dish Wireless. It's additional antennas on an existing structure at 2 College Hill Drive. They had no comments to that. It's outside the historic district, and it was already approved for additional antennas, the property and the monopole. On Thursday, January 13th, the Planning and Zoning Commission is going to hear two items. The first is the introduction of the 2021 City of Westminster Planning Annual Reporting Information. And again, this is the very first step. The introduction starts the process, it then goes back to the county, and then the county brings it back to the Planning Commission for a final review and endorsement. They will also be reviewing the proposed site development plan S29 for Valvoline Instant Oil Change. And this is located at the intersection of Gorsuch Road and Route 140. I've mentioned this project several times, but it does look like this time it is moving forward to the Planning Commission. We did obtain stormwater management concept approval. So that's good news. So it is on the agenda, and that completes my report. If you have any questions.
Seeing no questions for the planning department. Thank you, Mr. Depot. We will move on to the police department. Chief Ledwell.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. To continue with the COVID epidemic protocols, we have tightened some of our internal standard operating procedures to try to minimize the spread of the virus throughout the police department. We've been lucky that we have had cases, but they're only a few at a time, and we've been able to continue our operations because of that. To touch on what Councilman Cavacci talked about earlier, I have two things for our overdose mitigation plan. The first is that we held our first Cordata Health Solutions software collaborative meeting, and this is to help ensure the coordination of care and follow-up for persons post-overdose. And the participants in this meeting included the Cordata technical staff, our staff, the health department staff, and the hospital staff. So we're getting everybody on the same page. I think it's a great effort. And the second thing is that we were fortunate to have our state's attorney's office and people in our recovery community step up to provide nighttime phone coverage. So if we have an interaction with somebody during an overdose, we have the availability, kind of like we do with our current domestic violence advocate providers. So we can make the phone call, hopefully put the person in touch with somebody in recovery and get the ball rolling on trying to get that individual some help. So this will allow us to have that coverage at nighttime when we do have a number of overdoses and 7 days a week. So we're very thankful for that. As Councilman Cavacci talked about earlier, we just offered a job to a lateral police officer. His name is Alex Doherty. He'll start on February 1st. We also have two entry-level recruits, Javier Hernandez and John Dixon, who start February 1st and will go into the police academy on February 28th. We did take possession of three new police cruisers, which will all be marked patrol cruisers. They're scheduled for their emergency equipment outfitting and logo striping with our vendors. And they will replace three of our high mileage police vehicles, which will be auctioned. We also took possession of our first batch of new Motorola portable police radios. There were 12 of them. We're replacing our dated ones incrementally. And this will allow us to have continued communication with our allied agencies on all channels, things like encryption for some of our sensitive operations, et cetera. And they'll be supported as far as maintenance goes by our vendors. And that's all I have, unless there's any questions.
Hearing no questions, thank you, Chief Lovell. We will move on to the Department of Housing. Mr. Brown.
Good evening. Glad to see everyone in this new year. Wishing everybody good health and prosperity for the new year. With respect to housing, there are two initiatives we're working on this month into the next month. The first of which is cleaning up our waiting list of about 658 applicants. We hope that by the time we get through cleaning it up, it will be substantially less than that. We believe that there are some people on the waiting list that have been on there sometime and may have gone to other places or just given up. We may not be able to get in touch with them, but there'll be an opportunity for them to respond during this this period when we contact them. The second initiative will be this month that we'll be working on is getting out 1099s to the landlords that are participating in the Housing Choice Voucher Program. So that's going to be an undertaking for our staff. So those are the major things that we're working on, and that's all I have to report at this time.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Are there any questions for the Housing Department? Seeing none, we are going to move on to Human Resources. Before I introduce Ms. McCullough, I just want to reiterate what the council has already said, which is that the HR department has been working. It's a yeoman's job, really. And this has been going on well before the surge of Omicron, because we've had quite a few COVID cases up till October, really. So the HR department has been racing for months. And through the leadership of Ms. McCullough is still racing. So thank you. And we're happy to hear your report, ma'am.
Thank you. Well, the HR department, as been stated, we've been very busy assisting the other departments with recruiting, employee relations issues, and coordinating COVID testing and whatever else comes up. We're prepared, the HR team, to resolve whatever issues come up each day. We never know what's going to come up. So we've been very busy making it happen. I also would like to thank the mayor and council for recognizing the work efforts for the HR team during this busy time. Thank you. That's my report.
Are there any questions for the Human Resources Department? Seeing none, we will move on to the Public Works Department. Mr. Glass.
Yes, ma'am. First, I'd like to congratulate Steve Strasberg, the superintendent of the street department, and of course, everyone under his advisement there, for job well done for this related storm event that we just had. Also, I wanted to recognize Van Summerhill superintendent of the wastewater plant and all the wastewater employees as well for holding the ship together through this the COVID shortages that we've had. And then lastly, just everyone on your team, as a matter of fact, for it's all been stressful for this during this last probably month or so. But it's refreshing to me to see that everyone comes together and it's an adapt and overcome approach. And that's something we haven't had for a long time, but we have now. So I think that's going to be congratulated as well. So that's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Glass. There is no report for IT, Recreation and Parks, or Finance. Does anyone have any questions for those departments? Okay, so some final comments for me. I again want to welcome Mr. Barber, our new city clerk. We deemed Tuesday the 4th, which was the day he started, as Mr. Barber Day, and went around chanting about how excited we were for him to be here. And he's excited to be here as well, I'm sure. I also want to thank Dr. Wack with the Health Department. He provided a great deal of consultation and guidance in the last few weeks as we have had to pivot on COVID protocols for testing and COVID protocols for masking and social distancing and how to handle the employees and keep the operations running. I want to echo what Mr. Glass said and take a moment for those employees who are listening to thank them, all of you, for pivoting quickly. I know no one wants to be wearing masks right now, and we are, and everyone just did it and continued on with no issues, really. And we implemented some testing protocols that were sort of confusing, and everyone just got through it. And we've had several departments who have been, short staff isn't the right word, are on just a shoestring. And you know, a fourth of the department is in the building as opposed to the whole department. And those employees have just made it happen, and they're stressed out, and I know it, and we're gonna get through this, and it will be better on the other side. So I just wanna thank all of you who've been working so hard to pivot and keep the operations running. We appreciate it, and we appreciate you. And to the council, thank you as well for supporting us as we get through all this, and you have, and we will. And I want to remind you that I have asked you at the last council meeting for any budget requests that you may have. And I'm hoping that you'll send those to me by the next council meeting or at the very end of the month, if at all possible. And Mr. Cavacci, I imagine yours is going to be small, maybe not. But if anyone has some, you know, projects that you've been hoping to get done, or even problems you've been hoping to solve, if you want us to look at that for the upcoming budget, please send those requests to me and we'll consider that moving forward. Mr. President, that concludes the department reports.
All right. Thank you very much, Ms. Imhals. The final item on our agenda is citizen comments, when we invite the public to address the mayor and council on any issues that pertain to tonight's agenda or any other city issues. Unfortunately, because we're meeting virtually, we can't entertain those comments in person. And so we will invite people to do as we did during the virtual meetings earlier and continue to do anyway, to send us your comments or concerns via email at comments@westgov.com. Are we changing them, Ms. Imhals, to comments to, should be comments@westminstermd.gov?
It's on the agenda, I think, that way as well. Yes.
All comments received by email will be shared with the mayor and council. Commenters should please include their address and phone number with their comments. And that concludes our agenda and the meeting. Our next regular meeting will be held on Monday, January 24th, once again virtually. And with that, without objection, we are adjourned. Please stay safe and healthy.